All right, welcome everybody, and thanks for checking out another segment of Straight No Chaser, where I talk sports and culture for fans, oftentimes with the fans. Now, I know that right now we're in the midst of COVID-19, and everyone's squaring themselves away, making sure they're doing their part in keeping everyone safe. We got the reintroduction of sports on a national level. We got MLB starting, we got NBA. But I do want to shift a little bit from talk about sports to a little bit of a cultural issue, and that is tonight we're going to be discussing Black gun ownership in the Black communities and Second Amendment rights. But before we get into it, you know how we do it. Everybody grab a shot of your favorite libation. Raise them up if you got them. And we're about to get into it. Straight No Chaser. We'll wait on you. Ah, there it is. Salute. So, one of the things that one of the conversations I've been having with friends has been around Black gun ownership and Black communities and Second Amendment rights. Now, I know there's been a lot of conversation out there, a lot of dialogue. There's been some stereotypes, some truths, but also some misconceptions. So tonight I've got a group of panelists from across the country that are here to talk about Black gun ownership, because they are Black gun owners themselves, licensed carry holders. We also have instructors, enthusiast leadership positions as it relates to African-American gun ownership. I could go on and on, but I'll let them introduce themselves. So first we've got Chad King. Chad, can you talk a little bit about kind of how you became involved in gun ownership and your role in terms of how you have been able to introduce that into the community or your role within the community?
Yeah, so as he said, my name is Chad King. I'm the current president and co-founder of the Black Bottom Gun Club in Detroit, which is a chapter of the National African American Gun Association. Additionally, I am the National African American Gun Association Midwestern Regional Director. I'm also the chief instructor, owner-operator of Apex Defense Solutions, LLC. So I'm a firearm instructor as well. I'll say that my introduction to firearms it wasn't a good one when I was a kid, just growing up in the hood. You know, life happens in the hood, right?
Right.
So it was a positive, so much so that my mother didn't even want me to use rubber bands to make fake guns with a rubber band and point my finger at people.
Yes.
So I didn't grow up in a gun enthusiast world or a household. It wasn't until I had a tragic event happen to me in 2007 where I bought a shotgun.
Okay.
And I defended my family. I stayed up all night to defend my family with that shotgun for personal use. Fast forward a few years later, in 2017, we started the gun club. And really what we do, we try to emphasize the importance of exercising all of the rights imbued upon us as Americans, because this is something that our ancestors were denied, so we need to lay claim to it. And so we do that by way of obviously teaching and instructing people how to use a firearm safely and responsibly. We talk about firearm safety from an individual, family level, and a community level. We talk about the legal aspects of gun ownership and the history of Black gun ownership. I think all of that stuff is important. Beyond that, we do a lot of community service with our firearms on us, right? Because it's difficult to say that Black people with guns are this thing that you have the stereotype of when you see Black people with guns who are passing out book bags with school supplies or feeding people or passing out safety locks. So we do a lot of the community service work to challenge the narrative or challenge the stereotype of what Black gun ownership is and show what it actually is instead of what people think it is.
Great, great. And you touched on a couple of points that we're going to come back to, and that goes back to, and I'm sure, because I share a similar upbringing and perspective of guns were evil, guns were bad. You know, you couldn't even form your fingers, you know, to make a gun shape or, you know, put together rubber bands, things like that. You know, because there was a perception that there was this domineering feeling of lack of control and just what guns personified. So I definitely want to come back to that, because I'm sure you and I are going to be the only ones in that. Quincy, Thanks for joining on the show. I know you've been on before, but just a little bit about how you got involved with gun ownership and the role that you play in terms of how it relates to the community at large.
All right, just a quick intro for myself. My name is Dixon Q. I go by Q. I was the founder of the 761st Gun Club. I'm now the state director for NAGA for the state of Illinois. I started the chapter back in December of 2016. Right now we have about 3 chapters in the state of Illinois. One close to the Chicagoland area, one in Rockford, and one also we got a new one just started up in Zion earlier this month. My intro with guns. So my first intro with guns was actually when I joined the military, the Air Force. So back in 99. So I grew up in an anti-gun home, which was kind of funny because my mother, she grew up in the South. So she's a Bama girl, and she grew up during the Civil Rights Movement. And she was talking about how they had firearms in her home to defend the house with what's going on in the world back then. My father is from Ghana, so he's from Africa. So he came overseas over to the United States back in 1978. Okay. Didn't have too much exposure with firearms. He just knew that firearms were bad at the time. So we grew up, like what Chad said, I couldn't even do the rubber band thing. Water guns wasn't allowed in our house. And things like that. So it was fast forward to 99 when I joined the Air Force and actually went out to boot camp when we had our fifth week. It was Warrior Week, and we was going through M16 training, and that was my first time firing off a round on a rifle. So it was probably the most terrifying thing I ever went through. But and I was still terrified of firearms until my first deployment to support the Operation Iraqi Freedom, Operation Enduring Freedom. What I was in charge of at the time, I was the lowest guy in the totem pole, rank rise, and then I got all the sucky jobs, which was one of them was the weapon custodian, and then I had to get very familiar with firearms at that point. So I got a little bit comfortable with firearms. I think this is back in like 2004. And then I actually purchased my first firearm in 2016. I was at the point that I was worried about what society thought of me with a firearm. So it got to the point that I got frustrated that here I am, I served my country. I mean, I retired from the military last year, July of last year. So my thought process was, if I was good enough to die for this country and defend this country, I should be good enough to defend myself from those that want to do me harm. So meaning that the Second Amendment was just for me as well.
Great. See, Colin, are you still with us?
Oh yeah, I'm here.
Okay.
So much like you guys, you know, firearms were a little bit taboo in my household. I mean, we could have like water guns and, you know, stick guns, but, you know, cap guns and realistic looking guns were taboo. I remember my uncle came over one Christmas and brought us some, you know, Western guns and holsters and stuff like that. And my mom flipped out, you know, she like almost kicked him out the house, you know, she said, no guns in my house, you know. So, you know, it wasn't a gun friendly environment. I grew up in New York. But when we stepped outside the home, you know, you needed a gun. So, you know, I've had my hand on a gun since probably the age of 14 or 15. In 85, I enlisted in the United States Marine Corps, did 4 years in the Marine Corps, 85 to 89. And, you know, that's where I really got, you know, my training and education in firearms safety and marksmanship. So, you know, living in the North, you know, the gun laws are very restrictive. So I grew up in New York. I lived in New Jersey for quite some time, and it's very restrictive, very prohibitive. But I always felt the need to have one. And that's the thing about these laws is if you want to protect yourself and you're in a state where it's not gun friendly, you're criminalized. You know, you become a criminal just by the mere fact that you want to protect yourself and your family. But, you know, it's a price I'm willing to pay. Moved here to Georgia about 4 years ago and love it. You know, so I was in gun heaven over here. And, you know, it's just the freedom to be able to exercise your rights fully, as Chad said, all of your rights, and be able to, you know, educate others and bring them to the level that you're at is what's important to me. So in our chapter in Atlanta, we make sure that we create an environment where the newest gun owner to the one who's seasoned has an environment where they feel supported, and, you know, they're not chastised for asking questions. They can build their skills in an environment that's non-judgmental, right? And that's what we need in our community. We need that to normalize these firearms and give our community a historical perspective at the same time, to let them know that it's been in our community for years, right? We've just been restricted. So now it's time for us to reclaim that right. So I'm interested in everything everyone has to say, and being able to contribute to normalizing firearms in our community and the idea of armed self-reliance.
And you touched on some great talking points that we're going to get to. The normalization that African-Americans can carry guns. Gun ownership isn't a bad thing. Gun laws can be restrictive in certain areas of the country, certain states, even certain municipalities. And how do you maneuver around that perception of criminalization, because you do want to exercise your Second Amendment rights? So absolutely. So great. Thanks for joining us, Colin.
Yeah, no problem.
Stephanie, are you still with us?
Yes, sir, I am. Yes.
Great. So Stephanie, you're in Texas, correct?
I am. I'm in Houston, Texas now, but I am Brooklyn born and raised. So I'm a New York girl. A little bit of background about myself. I am also a U.S. Army veteran. That was actually my very first experience handling any type of firearm, which was an M16, and then I upgraded to my little M4. And then from there, I actually, once I got out of the military, I didn't touch a firearm for quite a few years. It wasn't until I moved down to Florida that I really opened my eyes more and was like, hey, this is something that I can get into. Something that I can make not only a hobby, but also enjoy and protect my family. So that's just a little bit of background about that. While in Florida, I did also start a local chapter of NAGA. I did that because the closest one was in Orlando, and I was out in the Tampa area, which was almost 3 hours away. Mm-hmm. I'm all about filling the gap and stepping in and filling that void. So I didn't see any chapter, anybody at the range like me. I didn't see any instructors in the area like me. So I wanted to set that standard. I wanted to set that precedent that we could do it, we can do it. And it doesn't always necessarily need to be a man that does it. We can take charge of our own protection and actually rewind. That brings me back to, you know, my roots. I was born and raised in Brooklyn, New York, one of the worst states for gun laws. But as a woman, I always knew that I needed to be protected. Every other day, you're hearing another woman being victimized in Central Park or Prospect Park or something going on. And you only realize that the cops are there to clean up the crime scene. Well, I don't want to be a victim. So, you know, life happened, and unfortunately I did have to realize in tough situations that I needed a firearm. I needed a means to self-defense, and I needed to train. It's not only the tool, but it's the mindset. So from there, I took off with it, and I'm enjoying it. Now I'm in Houston, Texas. I am the Texas State RSO, also assisting with the women's initiatives down here. So I'm just heavily involved in, you know, keeping our women active in our 2A community, as well as our families. You know, I have two little ones, 5 and 7, and they know the firearm safety rules, and we're about to start taking them to the range.
Yeah.
So, that's my business. Family Ties Firearms Training. So look me up.
You know, it's interesting, and I love the fact that we've got this group here. It's a group diverse in the sense that from different parts of the country, from different areas, different upbringings, but there's still that commonality, one of which being African-American, but also growing up in situations where guns weren't prevalent, but in some way, we have been introduced to guns in our life, and we've embraced it. We haven't shut that down. We haven't turned our backs on it. We've embraced it. We've been engaging with it, and we haven't let our upbringing deter us. So a little bit about me. I grew up in a household where guns weren't allowed. Actually, my stepdad was a military person. He had firearms in the house, but I don't know how legal they were growing up. But I say that to say, guns were prevalent in the African-American community. They were prevalent in our household, but it was something that as a child, I was steered and taught to fear guns, taught to fear being around people with guns, taught that guns were evil, that guns didn't mean well for any type of situation. And really it was that ignorance that I grew up with that made me even more curious about gun ownership, because to Stephanie's point, I had a couple friends that invited me out to the range as an adult. And I was intimidated because I had this history growing up of not being exposed to, whereas these people were more seasoned. Now these people had another level of familiarity. But then when I got there, there was nobody that looked like me when I got there. And then also when you go there and you're the only person of color, it also can be somewhat intimidating. And those were some of the things that for me even piqued my curiosity even more and wanted to learn more about gun ownership, become a gun owner, but then also more importantly, be able to protect my family.